What's going on, UB? You guys got your popcorn ready? All right, for those of you that do not know me, I am Mike Powers, and I am the chairman of the University of Buffalo's Young American for Freedom chapter. For those of you who are unfamiliar with Young Americans for Freedom, we are the premier student activist organization in the conservative movement. We work hard to educate our fellow students on American founding principles, things like individual freedom, free enterprise, a strong national defense, and the tradition of American values that made our country so great. I hope that all of you enjoy tonight. If any of you would like to see more things that are carried out like this at the University of Buffalo, or if you just want to stay up to date with our plans this school year, remember to sign at the front table of the newsletter out by the entrance. Tonight, I'd like to thank all those who made this event possible. I want to thank Fred Allen, whose dedication made this live stream possible so that the university students and tens of thousands of others across the nation could join us tonight for this excellent event. Now, I'd like to share a little bit of wisdom with you guys as a nice segue into this event. Learn to let go of everything you're afraid to lose and stay the course. People will doubt you, people will slander your name, and people will do everything to destroy you. If you stay true to your heart, nothing will ever destroy your will. The furthest you will ever fall from failure is the top of your hat to the heels of your boots. Know that immature strategy is a source of great injury. While relaxing the surface of your mind, make its depth strong, not allowing others to discern your mind. Remember, as a leader, you must not allow your mind to become clouded. Rather, make it expansive, and in this broadness, you should place your wisdom. It is of utmost importance to polish both your wisdom and mindset devotedly. Sharpen your mindset to become indestructible. Observe the leadership around you and take note. A majority of the time, the leader you're looking for stares back at you in the mirror. Continue to do great things in life and never let anyone steer you off the path to success. Those who tell you there is nothing out there gave up on their dreams and aspirations a long time ago. The life you seek is just beyond the horizon. Take this perspective with you and know that what was in your heart all along is how you should carry yourself. Right now, I'd like to introduce you to a young high school student from Fairport High School in Rochester by the name of Elijah Pender.
I would like to thank you all today for giving me the opportunity to speak. Thank you, YAF, for hosting such a wonderful event. And thank you, UB, for allowing the university students to partake in an event that supports the freedom of speech. My name is Elijah, and I'm a high school student at Fairport High School. Conservatism is not so popular where I go to school, nor is it really encouraged. Liberal viewpoints are considered and treated as fact, and anyone who deviates from these beliefs is considered to be ignorant or intolerant. I happen to be a huge fan of Ben Shapiro. I've watched numerous hours of Ben dismantling the likes of social justice warriors, CNN anchors, and plenty of ill-prepared leftists. What started out as entertainment quickly became an educational tool for me the more I observed. It is because of Ben that I've decided to involve myself into politics at such a young age. I am grateful for Ben Shapiro's logical reasoning because it reinforces conservative beliefs. He arms us with the facts so we may negate the illogical arguments that leftists present. I'm so glad that I'm 18 and registered to vote, because if Ben runs in 2024, I know who I'm voting for. UB, let's please welcome Mr. Ben Shapiro.
Coming out. I really appreciate it. This hammer was given to me by UBYAF. This is the best gift I've gotten at any of this. Yeah. Just to beat everybody to the meme, yes, it's a normal-sized gavel. Yes. And it says upon it, Hebrew hammer, whosoever holds this hammer, if he be worthy, shall possess the power of Shapiro. So far, so good. Well, it's amazing to be here at University at Buffalo. When I was growing up, I actually always had a soft spot for the Buffalo Bills. I used to watch Jim Kelly play. And when my wife and I were dating, we actually decided to take a trip around Christmas time to Niagara Falls, which is just something Californians think is a good idea. So that's the last time I was in Buffalo. That was 11 years ago, and it was not good. And I'll say that. We had just been engaged, and we did a trip where we went to Philadelphia and Washington, D.C., and then we decided we would go to Niagara Falls for New Year's, not realizing, of course, that there's this thing called snow and cold. And so we got up here. There was no food, because I keep kosher. We keep kosher. So all we had was literally for 24 hours a bag of bagel chips. And I remember that we went to a local Holiday Inn because we couldn't afford anything else. And we stopped at the front desk and we said, we need a limo to, we need some sort of car. We just need a car to get to Niagara Falls. And of course, this being a relatively cheap hotel, the person behind the desk had some sort of kickback arrangement with some guy. And so us being idiots, we were like, sure, that guy. So the guy pulls up and he's driving about a 1979 Cadillac limousine with a red velvet interior. And we trepidatiously get in the back of the limo, and we have our bag, clutching our bag of bagel chips like the poor urchins that we were. And the limo driver starts talking to us. He tells us that he's been married 6 times, and he explains that he is hungry and reaches back into our bag of bagel chips and proceeds to start noshing on our only food. And then decides he's gonna give marital advice to my wife, and I figure, okay, he's married 6 times, he must know something. And the only piece of advice that I actually remember was him just saying over and over and over, keep the spice alive. And her looking at me like, I want to die. The good news is we've been married for 10 years. The bad news is we haven't been back to Buffalo since. But this is a lot better. This is a lot better. So I really appreciate you guys coming out. Well, tonight I want to talk about the hot topic of the day, the relations between men and women. If you listen to the media, or if you live on a college campus, chances are pretty good you think that we here in the United States are in the middle of a war between the sexes. And that, of course, is particularly true following the saga of Brett Kavanaugh that we just watched, in which the political left, including the mainstream Democratic Party, decided that belief in the presumption of innocence and due process of law did not apply to men. They decided that if you're a Republican man, or if you're a conservative man, or if indeed you are merely a textualist interpreting constitutional scholar of a man, then this means that any accusation should be enough to take you down. Now, none of this is to say that we shouldn't take accusations seriously. Of course, we should. But before you can destroy a man's life, it appears that you might need one shred of corroborating evidence, like anything. And the fact that the left refused that was just an example of the left trying to polarize the Democratic Party, trying to polarize the country on an issue where basically everybody agrees. See, this is the thing about the Me Too movement. Everybody basically agrees with the point. No one who is of good heart wants to see women mistreated. No one who is of good heart wants to see women who are sexually assaulted and sexually mistreated not taken seriously. We all agree with this. But the left in this country has an unfortunate habit, and that is that on issues where we all agree, the left will pick a bad example, and then when people react badly to the bad example, they will suggest that the main principle is being disrespected. So they will say, well, we all believe in Me Too. And we'll say, right, we all believe in Me Too. And then they'll say, okay, well, how about we ruin this guy's life based on an uncorroborated allegation from 36 years ago? And they're like, well, we might want, like, some evidence, please. And they go, oh, you don't believe in Me Too. If you believed in Me Too, then obviously you would want this guy's life ruined. Now, all of this makes for some pretty ugly talk. It makes for a pretty ugly climate in the room. It's rather insane, and it's particularly insane in a society where women are treated better than any society in the history of mankind. Okay, to put America's female existence in perspective, America's females are freer, richer, more prosperous, less ill-treated than any women in the history of humankind ever, bar none. There may be an argument about whether some women are treated better in places like Norway, but that's about the only argument. Now, I want to talk tonight about the radical feminist movement, because here's the truth. The modern feminist movement, which has radicalized itself, is a disgraceful departure from the original feminist movement. I believe that I am an original feminist. Not because I'm old, but just because I believe in the principles of original feminism. I think original feminism was about certain basic rights, basic human equality, the ability for women to vote, to get any job for which they were qualified, to make decisions about marriage and child rearing for themselves. I believe in all of those things. When I was growing up, my mom was the one who worked, and my dad stayed at home with the kids. I am rather famously married to a doctor myself. I spend more time at home with my own kids than my wife does because she chooses to be a doctor. And then when she is done with her residency, she wants to work on a per diem basis so she can spend more time with the kids. And I support her choices all the way through. When she took time off with our kids, I supported it. And when she does not take time off because she wants to get through her residency, I support it because I am essentially a feminist. But that's first wave feminism. Then came the radicals. Feminism moved from being about achieving equal rights for women to something different. Instead, feminism was turned into a fight over three chief ideas. One, men and women are absolutely identical. Not they have equal rights, not they should be treated with equal opportunity, but they are absolutely identical. There are no differences between men and women. Second, that the patriarchy, every institution of American society, the freest, best society in the history of mankind, all of those institutions are reflective of an evil patriarchal system. And finally, we need a new standard. We need new mores to replace the old patriarchal standard. So these are the three ideas. Men and women are exactly the same. The patriarchy is responsible for everything bad. Tear down the patriarchy and replace it with something new. Now, these ideas were all based on one central point, that all social wrongs are the product of power hierarchies, that all inequities, that all inequalities are inequities, that any disproportion between men and women in any particular sphere of life had to be due to some sort of discrimination, as opposed to free choice that manifests as disproportion. Foundational pillars of Western civilization, according to this radical feminist take, could be torn down without harming women. Such destruction would actually empower women, but that's not what happened. These ideas were catastrophically, terribly, horribly wrong. Tonight we're going to look at how radical feminism ruined the most important institutions in a functioning society, and in the process actually leads to less happiness for women. But before that, we have to start with some basic science. So I hate to break it to the gender studies majors in the room. Number one, I don't know where you're going to get a job. That's the first thing I hate to break to you. But there are only so many jobs at academic journals that publish papers about dog park rape and such. But that was actually a reference to an actual paper that was published by a feminist journal. I don't know if you followed this story. It's a great story. Apparently, there are these academics who published 7 fake papers in top academic journals in gender studies. And one of them was about how dog parks and dogs humping one another was actually a reinforcement for heteronormativity. This was published in a gender studies journal. So I wasn't just making that up, okay? Here's the second thing I hate to break to the gender studies major in the class. Sex is not a social construct. Sex is not a social construct. And gender is not a social construct. Now, the idea that gender and sex are completely separate is, of course, very silly. There are certain aspects of gender, masculine and feminine, that are, of course, social constructs. But that does not mean that the vast majority of things that distinguish men from women are social constructs. That's just nonsense. Men and women, on average, are not the same. You know how I know this? Because I have functioning retinas and a functioning prefrontal cortex. I have a child. I have 2 children. One is a girl. One is a boy. They are extraordinarily different because boys and girls are different. We used to know these things because we had not frontally lobotomized ourselves to facts. Men and women, boys and girls, they are not identical in how they think, what they desire, or how they act. They are not identical in various areas of mental aptitude. In some cases, women are stronger, and in some cases, men are stronger. Or in distribution of aptitude in various fields, or in physical aptitude. Treating men and women as identical, as though they are identical, suggesting they are the same, except for the penis or the vagina, is anti-scientific idiocy. When people say things like, the penis is not a gendered, organ. What? There's an actual push a few weeks ago for people to call vaginas front holes because they didn't want to. I mean, I can't imagine what President Trump would even say about that on an Access Hollywood tape. As Harvard Psychology professor Steven Pinker says differences between the sexes are part of the human condition. And by the way, they're a great part of the human condition. One of the nice things about life is that men and women are different. This attempt to obliterate differences between men and women, beyond being idiotic and anti-scientific, is actually no fun at all. Okay, we call average attributes and behaviors of men masculinity. We call average attributes and behaviors of women femininity. Gender studies theorists, as overpaid navel gazers, try to separate gender from sex, suggesting that attributes and behaviors are entirely socially constructed. Of course, there may be some behaviors that are socially constructed, as I said, but to honestly believe that all gender differences are separate from sex requires that you were dropped on your head as a baby, repeatedly. Like your parents dropped you, and then they picked you up again and forcibly turned you upside down and then dropped you again on your head. Boys and girls are different. For example, many gender theorists have attempted to claim that boys and girls only like different toys because evil corporations decided that boys should have guns and girls should have dolls. Sweden has actually attempted to force boys to play with dolls and to force girls to play with guns or trucks or stereotypically masculine toys. This is silly talk. Okay, play differences between the sexes exist in rhesus monkeys. They really do. They've done studies. They found that our primate ancestors have sexual differences between how they treat toys. This is biologically innate. To take another example, the distribution of men and women in terms of mathematics performance is different. Studies suggest that while men and women on average perform the same in math, the bell curve is not exactly the same. Men tend to have a much more shallow bell curve, and women tend to have a steeper bell curve. What that means is that the fat tail ends of the bell curve are different. Right? So while the average can be the same, if the bell curve for mathematics IQ for women, for example, looks like this, okay, then the tail ends are a lot thinner. If it looks like this for men, the average is the same, but the fat tail ends are a lot thicker. That means you got a lot of men who are really dumb at math and a lot of men who are really smart at math. Okay, that means that the distribution in top companies for those fields may in fact be determined, at least in part, by differences in aptitude with regard to this stuff. That's not sexist. Okay, that's just reality. And that's not horrible, it's not terrible. It's also true that women are better than men at a great many things, including interpersonal relationships, which is why the vast majority of people who are in interpersonal relationship fields tend to be women. And yes, men and women differ in how they treat sex too. I know this is a big bugaboo for radical feminists. You're not supposed to talk about this. Men and women are supposedly we treat sex exactly the same. Again, have you met a man? Have you met a woman? Men are far more interested in variety and frequency than women on average. Women are far more interested in stability, comfort, and intimacy. Why? Because evolution says so. The reason evolution says so is because men are attempting to spread their genetic material, and women have to be selective about exactly whom they select to be the people with whom they mate. Because women only get a couple of shots at deciding who the dad of the baby is going to be. Whereas men can basically go out and do whatever they want. Hey, evolution drives male sex drive. It is not the same thing as female sex drive. And the idiocy that suggests it is just that. It's just unbelievably stupid. My favorite example of this, there's a very famous experiment by a couple of academics named Clark and Hatfield from 1989. And here's what they did. What they did is they got an attractive male and an attractive female, and they sent these people into bars to try and pick people up. So they had the men and this attractive man go into a bar and find all the women in the bar and say to them, "Want to come home tonight and have sex with me?" And then they had a woman go into the bar and say to all the men in the bar, "Want to come home tonight and have sex with me?" Hey, you're all laughing because you know the result before I say it. Men, because men are pigs, said yes 75% of the time. We are built to be pigs. That's what we do. That's why we need civilization and marriage to civilize us and make us better and channel all those aggressive, terrible instincts toward actually building a home and a life and defending women and building civilizations. Right? It's why we created a civilization, was to stop men from being who they naturally are. 75% of men said, "Hell yeah, let's do this thing." Okay, you know what percentage of women said yes to this proposition? Zero. Zero. No women. Not a woman. Why? Because women aren't idiots about sex. Only men are idiots about sex, as a general rule, unless the feminist movement teaches them that it's actually valuable and feminist to be an idiot about sex. Then we can indulge our seamier side. As psychologists say, there is a reason that sperm is cheap and eggs are expensive. Okay, so let's start with institutions that radical feminism has had a massively terrible impact on. Let's start with the central institution for any functioning society, and that, of course, is the institution of marriage. So marriage is innately an amazing institution for women. For women. Okay, that does not mean that every aspect of marriage was always great for women. Obviously, legal arrangements where women were supposedly men's property were bad. Bigamy was awful, right? There were certain aspects of marriage that were bad. But the monogamous standard of marriage and its place as the traditional standard in society was really, really good for women. Why? Because men could not logically expect women to go to bed with them without a serious commitment. Men were expected to value women's priorities. You actually had to, in the words of Nicholas Nassim Taleb, and this is not meant with any sort of pornographic reference, have some skin in the game. You actually had to attempt to make a commitment to another human being before the woman was expected to act in any sexual way. Men were expected to value stability and comfort and intimacy in a way men naturally do not when it comes to sex. Because marriage was actually about more than just pleasure. Marriage was about building a life together. Mostly, marriage was about raising kids that you were going to have together. And the vast majority of marriage for all of human civilization was based around the idea you were going to have kids with the person that you married. That was what marriage was based around. And so you had to choose based on your brain, not on what's going on downstairs. You're supposed to choose based on your brain. Is this a person I think is fit to raise my children, have children with, build a family with, and invest my time in? Then radical feminists decided that marriage had to be destroyed. They portrayed marriage as an awful cage. Betty Friedan, famous brain challenge feminist, suggested that marriage was a, quote, comfortable concentration camp. That is a direct quote. She equated American marriage with concentration camp. She did this about 20 years after the Holocaust, so she was really, really with it. In fact, women didn't need men at all. As Gloria Steinem said, a woman needed a man like a fish needed a bicycle. Marriage could only survive by turning into sort of a rom-com, right? And then this is how we get the rom-com version of marriage. What marriage really is two people fall in love and they get mutual pleasure from each other, and that's why they get married. There's only one problem with this. Okay, that's not actually how marriage works, as any married person in the room can tell you. That's not how marriage works. You fall in love with somebody, and then you look for values that you share with that person if you want to have a good marriage. Because, as Jonathan Haidt talks about in his book, The Happiness Hypothesis, when it comes to relationships, at the very beginning of a relationship between a man and a woman, passion levels are very high, and what they call committed love is very low, because you don't know the person very much. And then, over time, passionate love declines, because you're used to the person, and committed love goes way up. But if all you're expecting is passionate love from a marriage all the time, you're going to get bored around year three. And this is just innate to how human beings operate with one another. So if what you were expecting was to build a home with a person, with commitment related, then you're getting what you expect in marriage. If what you were expecting is a never-ending joy of passionate lovemaking in Hawaii, forget it. It's not happening, guys. Okay, but this lie was perpetrated, and so marriage suddenly had different expectations. Pew shows the top reason people now say they get married is love at 88%. Followed by making a lifelong commitment at 81% and companionship at 76%. All of these involve you and your spouse. What are the actual reason for marriage? You know, like having babies and bringing them up, which as we will discuss in a second, I will explain why this is the actual reason for marriage. Only 49% of people say they get married to have kids, and only 30% of people say they get married to have their marriage recognized in any religious fashion. Now, listen, love is great. I love my wife. Commitment is great. I am committed to my wife. The reason I married my wife is because she is the person not only I wanted to spend the rest of my life with, she is the person I wanted to build a family with and raise children with. And she felt the same about me. And that's why we're 10 years in and going strong, thank God. With the change in how we see marriage as a mutually pleasurable arrangement as opposed to a goal-oriented partnership between two people, so are women happier after all of this? Right, this is the big question. Are we happier after all of this? Well, nope. So it turns out, economists Betsy Stevenson and Justin Wolfers did a study on happiness trends among American citizens between 1970 and 2005. Now, 1970 is right around the time the radical feminist movement really starts to take over the country. What did they find? Well, it turns out men rated their overall life satisfaction higher than men in the 1970s. I wonder why. Might it have something to do with less commitment and more promiscuity? But what happened to women? Well, women's happiness scores decreased. So men stayed relatively stable, but women's happiness scores decreased. I can't imagine how that happened. And the gap between male and female happiness actually is reflected in Europe too. So it's not just an American problem. This is a Western problem. Women are now getting married later than ever, median age 28. Divorce rates are increasing. Marriage rates are steadily declining. Is any of this really great for men or women? I would argue not. I would argue that it's actually a pretty negative impact on a lot of women. There are studies that show that of all the women who don't have kids, only 10% select not to have kids. When you ask women who are 45, 50 years old, never had kids, why didn't you have kids? Only 10% say, I didn't want them. Which means that a huge percentage of women who didn't have kids just couldn't. And not for biological reasons necessarily. right? Maybe because they got married too late, maybe because they were too invested in career. Life is a series of trade-offs, and if we fail to recognize that trade-offs exist, what you're doing is lying to people. Okay, so radical feminism hasn't just impacted marriage in negative ways, it's also impacted in really severe negative ways motherhood and child rearing. The death of marriage wasn't just bad for women and men, it was really, really terrible for children. Disconnecting marriage from children didn't stop kids from being born, it just meant the kids didn't have dads. Single motherhood is the single greatest barrier to intergenerational economic growth in the United States. It is not close. On average, single motherhood damages children in irreparable ways, controlling for socioeconomic factors. The strongest predictor of doing prison time is single parenthood. Children from single-parent families account for 63% of all youth suicides, 70% of all teenage pregnancies, 71% of all adolescent substance abuse, 90% of homeless and runaway children. So while it may have been fun not to get married to that guy, it's not quite as fun when he's not around to help raise the kid. But this is what the radical feminist movement was proposing. Remember, a woman needs a man like a fish needs a bicycle, unless it turns out that they're little fish. Then you might need another fish around to help take care of things. Single motherhood means that women themselves are trapped in poverty all too often. It's just bad for women. The poorest coterie in the United States of women are single moms. Now, radical feminists have a solution to this. They say, okay, just teach women not to have babies. That'll solve everything. Right? Then you don't have to worry about single motherhood. Just teach them that they don't have to have babies. This is what Simone de Beauvoir, author of The Second Sex and existentialist partner of Sartre, actually said. She said, quote, no woman should be authorized to stay at home to raise her children. She says the government should ban people from staying at home to raise their kids. Society should be totally different. Women should not have that choice. We should take away the choice. Why? Because if there is such a choice, too many women will make that choice. So you have radical feminists actually arguing that women should be restricted in their choices because radical feminists want women to act a certain way. I'm not saying that because I'm an actual feminist. I want women to be able to choose what they want to do. Radical feminists are saying we have to encourage women not to make their own choices. We have to discourage them from making choices we don't like, such as staying home with their kids more often. Except it turns out that women actually kind of like having babies, right? This notion that women don't want to have babies is so bizarre. Again, has anyone ever met a 35-year-old single woman? 35-year-old single women, there are some who choose not to be married. That's fine. The vast majority of women who are 35 and single are not supremely happy about being 35 and single and not having kids. Radical feminists then say that the priority, even if you have kids, is career. What you should do is you should have a baby. And then you should go work someplace, and you should make some money, and then you should pay some other lady to take care of your kid. That's the goal, right? And that's how it works in California, where I am from. In California, the reason that illegal immigrant labor is so prevalent in suburbia is specifically because of this. You basically hire an illegal immigrant from a different country to come and mother your child while you go to work specifically, like you're making 50 grand a year, and you're paying that 50 grand to another person to take care of your kid. Really, this is what's happening. Now, this is not actually what a lot of women want. This is why people talk about the gender gap, okay? The reason the gender gap exists in terms of income is because women choose to have babies and spend more time at home. This is the main driver of the gender gap, and that's not a bad thing. I don't understand for the life of me, why we are telling women that their best and greatest superpower, creating another human from their own body, is less important than working as an associate law clerk. Working 2,100 billable hours, checking footnotes, is somehow more important than raising the next generation of human beings that you made with your own body and then bringing them up. Now, some people may choose that. Fine, again, for the 1,000th time, that's fine, do what you want, it's a free country. But if you're going to indoctrinate women to believe that happiness comes from working as an accountant, but not from spending more time with your children, there's not a single person who on their deathbed said, I wish I had done one more doc review. Not one. I speak as someone who worked at a law firm. Now, in order to preserve the myth that work as an accountant is more important than the actual female superpower of creating individual humans with your own body and then nourishing them using your own body, radical feminists have convinced men and women that the solution to all of this is abortion, that true feminism relies on abortion. What we really need to do is, obviously, if female empowerment means not having babies and not spending time with babies, then real female empowerment means killing babies, right? Just get rid of them. You got a baby in the womb, so what? Your autonomy is more important than that baby. Now, for the pro-choicers in the room, I don't care about your body. I'm not interested in controlling your body. I don't want any part of your body. I'm a happily married man. What I do want is for you to stop trying to carve apart the other body that's inside your body. Okay, that's what I care about. I care about the other human in there. But radical feminists say, I'm not allowed to care about that. I'm a man. How can I say anything like that? How can a man have anything to say about the uterus? Because, as we all know, logic just simply stops if you're a man talking about this sort of thing. I mean, it's basically the same argument as saying you weren't a slaveholder in 1850s America, so how can you say anything about slavery? Stupidest argument in the world. Stupidest argument in the world. If a human rights violation is going on, if something that is morally harmful and irreparably harmful is going on, you have a duty as a moral human being to speak up about it. The carnage, by the way, since 1970, is about 50 million unborn children in the United States terminated before birth. Okay, finally, a couple other notes. So, you know, I want to get to the good part. Okay, so the best part is with regard to sexual relations, obviously, because radical feminists have ruined sex. They have. They've ruined sex. Okay. The feminist movement originally made a correct assessment. They made an absolutely correct assessment. Men were acting like pigs. I agree. Traditionalists said the same thing. Wow, that's human nature. Men act like pigs. Right, we know. That's why we created a civilization, to stop men from doing such things. Men were acting like pigs. And the feminists said that pornography, the pornography industry, treated women like meat and treated men to treat women like meat, which is also true. And then they said that men were being held to a double standard, which was also true, that men were not expected to be, were not expected to hold themselves in or treat women with dignity, but women were expected to treat themselves with honor and dignity. All of that was true. And then feminists did the stupidest thing possible. They said, what about if we just have women act like men? Not ask men to act like human beings, ask women to act like men. So men act like pigs and we will act like men, and then everybody will be a pig together. It'll be great. And then they said, well, you know, the porn industry, like, look at the flip from the feminists on the porn industry. It's just amazing. They went from, in the 1970s and 1980s, saying pornography is evil because pornography objectifies women, to now pornography is a sign of female empowerment. Men will never stop laughing at how they somehow did this. I mean, legitimately, men will never stop laughing at this joke. It is the greatest prank ever pulled in the history of mankind, that women somehow convinced themselves that pornography was empowering. There is not a man alive who watches pornography who thinks, boy, there is a strong, independent lady. Now, the lie was that women were going to be more sexually satisfied by this arrangement. You know, when they were married, they could only have sex with this one guy, and that was boring, and that was lazy, but now we can have affairs with whoever we want. We can have sex all the time. Yay, great. Only one problem. Only one problem. Virtually every study ever done shows that women have significantly more and better sex when they are in committed relationships. Women want intimacy and sex. They do. Okay, in a way that guys don't. All you have to, to ask a guy whether to have sex or not, if you ask a guy, do you want to have sex, his only question is, what time? If you ask a woman if she wants to have sex, you first have to ask her a different question. Why? Right, why? Like, women actually want to know why, which seems like a good question. But the feminist movement suggested that why was a bad question. It should also be like men. It should just be when. Okay, the problem is that women don't actually treat sex like men do. They don't. Women want that intimacy, and if they don't get that intimacy, then they are confused and they are upset far more often than men. It's not true for every woman, but on average, women want a different thing from sex than men want from sex. For men, sex is much more about physical release, and for women, it's a lot more about emotional intimacy. Again, for evolutionary reasons. And this notion that if you just cast away emotional intimacy and then you just have sex with random strangers, that this is somehow gonna make your life better. I don't, like, my God, how did this, who was able to perpetrate such a notion? It's unbelievable. It's idiotic for any number of reasons, okay? First of all, women are more physically vulnerable than men. You may have noticed this. Women are smaller and more physically vulnerable than men. And as we know, are far more often sexually abused. Do you think that women feel more comfortable or less comfortable in the presence of a stranger they just met 5 minutes ago who wants to have sex with them? What do you think? 28% of all rapes are committed by a stranger, another 45% are committed by an acquaintance, 25% are committed by a boyfriend or spouse. Okay, what this means is that marriage, relationships don't prevent rape, but they are also the vast minority of rapes in the country. Men who are emotionally invested in their spouses may commit sexual assault against wives and girlfriends, but they do so less often than strangers do. And there are a lot more men in relationships than having sex with strangers. Second, the traditional standard for sex used to be marriage, right? The societal presumption was that a woman didn't actually want to have sex with a man outside of marriage, so there was no expectation. And that expectation, you talk to a lot of young women, I talk to young women all over the country, a lot of them, who feel, they will say that they feel pressured into sex by men. They feel like they have to have sex with men in order for the man to take them seriously. They feel like the man has an expectation of sex. Well, in society, where marriage is the barrier to sex, that expectation went unfulfilled because everybody basically assumed that was ridiculous. But in a situation where men expect sex and women feel pressure to give sex in order to generate a relationship out of it, that is not good for women. That's not good for women. Well, we got rid of all the sort of traditional notions of what you had to do before you had sex. You know, courting a woman, trying to form a relationship with her, making decisions about values, getting married. We got rid of all of those basic presumptions. And now consent is the only standard. And that sounds good, right? Consent sounds great, because we all like consent. Consent's awesome, right? And in every area of life, consent is awesome. Well, there's only one problem. There's only one problem with this. It turns out that in matters of sex, there's some gray area when it comes to exactly how sexual relations work. That does not mean, there's black and white area, okay? So the black and white area is a guy wants to have sex, the woman says no, and then he violates her, right? That's black and white. We all agree that is a violation of consent. But what about when two people get drunk, go back to their dorm room, hook up? Was that some sort of sexual abuse? Was that a grave sin? Was that a rape? According to Title IX trials on campuses all over the country, it could be. That's why they've now instituted yes means yes in California, which is this bizarre standard where you're supposed to legitimately ask, like, I don't even know how you break down the gradations. Right? The idea is supposed to be that you ask, okay, may I kiss you now? May I touch your leg? May I touch your shoulder? May I stroke your hair? It's like Zeno's paradox. Like, you have to get smaller and smaller in the areas of consent that you are asking. Right? There's a very funny bit in a Zooey Deschanel show, New Girl, where she's in high school and she wants to have sex with this guy she's been dating. It's prom night, and he's one of these guys. And he starts asking, can I kiss you? Can I touch your leg? And eventually she says, you can do whatever you want with me, just stop asking me all the questions. And then he says, you're being so aggressive with me, I don't know if I want to do this anymore. So she goes out and she has sex with, like, the gardener, right? But the reality is that not a single sexual act has ever been consummated in this fashion. No one has a signed, notarized, yes means yes checklist when they have sex. No one ever in history. And it doesn't sound all that sexy, to be honest with you. But this nebulous state, encouraging promiscuity based solely on a vaguely defined consent where two people are drunk, or a guy says, do you want to do something? A girl says no, and then he starts kissing her, and then she says yes. Did she say no or did she say yes? Right? To pretend this stuff doesn't exist is to, again, blind yourself to reality in the name of political correctness. If all the lines were this black and white, I would agree with them. But they are not always that black and white. Heather McDonald reports today, in 2015, the Association of American Universities conducted a sexual assault survey at 27 selective colleges. The vast majority of survey respondents, whom the AAU researchers classified as sexual assault victims, never reported their alleged assaults to their college's rape hotlines, sexual assault resource centers, or Title IX offices, much less to campus or city police. Why? Because they self-reported they did not think that what happened to them was that serious. Right? So that means that a lot of the statistics about unreported sexual assault depends on the woman's subjective perception of what exactly is going on. Radical feminism has encouraged that sort of subjectivity and then set no closing standard on the other end. This leaves women in a gray area and men in a gray area. It puts men in danger of being accused of things that they may not have done, and it puts women in danger of men believing they can push beyond boundaries of what is appropriate and normal. Radical feminism has undermined all of these things, again, based on that simple presumption that men and women are exactly the same. They are not. We all want to protect women. The only way that we can protect women and protect due process and protect the presumption of innocence is with some clear, actual, articulable standards. So what am I recommending after all of this? Well, I'm recommending a word that's kind of gone out of style these days between the sexes. Dignity. Men and women treating each other as individuals with honor, as creatures of God, everybody made in God's image. And it's your duty and your joy to honor and protect the person with whom you want to be intimate. Women treating themselves as worthy of that honor and demanding that honor from men. Like, that is what I am calling for. And if that sounds simple, that's because it actually is. It is not complex. Human nature is complex. Human nature is difficult. But setting moral standards is actually not that hard if you're committed to doing it. But if you're committed instead to tearing down those moral standards in the name of some brave new world, then of course you're going to end up in a really nasty gray area, which is where we are right now. What we require right now is a commitment to dignity and to honor. And that requires hard work, and it requires a commitment to women. Most of all, it requires decency. And if we can all be decent to one another, then we're all feminists in the end. Thanks so much. righty, so now we're doing Q&A, which is the good part. I brought my hammer just in case. So, as always, the rule is that if you are a person who disagrees, you go first. That's always the rule.
Way, please go around outside the back. Thank you.
You know, while we're waiting, can we just do something? Let's give a quick round of applause to the security here, the police officers. And also, you know what? The administration did what they were supposed to do, right? I mean, we were able to have this event in peace and quiet, which is really nice. So thank you to the administration here at University of Buffalo. Go for it,
Sam. Hey, how's it going? I'm a huge fan of yours. What I really wanted to say was I find it really hard to have a civil discussion with people from the opposite side because I want to learn more about their point of view, and sometimes they want to learn more about my point of view. What do you think the best way about going about kind of, you know, having the groundwork, like, all right, you know, let's present each other's side and actually discuss it and not let's devolve into a screaming match?
I mean, the first thing you have to do is you actually have to do a little bit of assessment as to whether the person you're talking to wants to have a conversation with you. Right? There are only a few reasons to have a conversation with somebody on the left. One is to actually have a discussion. You might find somebody on the left who actually wants to exchange ideas. Kind of rare, but it happens. You could also have a situation where you just want to hone your own ideas, so you're arguing for your own purposes, or you're debating somebody on a stage, in which case your goal is basically to humiliate that person as badly as possible. But you have to decide which conversation is which, and also, you know this. I mean, everybody knows this, but they don't apply it. They get in a Facebook fight, and then five posts in, and an hour later, they're like, oh, I wish I hadn't done that. Think. With the first post, is this a thing that's going to help me, or is this a thing that's just a waste of time?
And I don't know if I can ask afterward. Can I get a picture with you after the conversation?
I'll try to stick around as long as I can, yeah.
Thank you.
Hey, Ben. I'm 14 years old. I'm a huge fan. I'm from Rochester. And I'm a conservative, and the New York public school, like, education system makes it really hard for me to spread my, like, conservative viewpoints, like, my friends, my community. And as you can see, my shirt says Ben Shapiro 20, and I was just wondering if at any point in the future, could we possibly see you running for office of any kind?
So a few years ago, I probably would have said yes, because it was something I was interested in. Watching as public figures get absolutely destroyed personally, it makes me less likely to do it. I think our politics is such right now that decent people, and I try to consider myself decent people are sort of being driven out of the public square. People who have no shame or honor, I think, are being encouraged to run for office on every side of the aisle. You know, I could see a possibility sometime in the future. It won't be in 2020, but I appreciate the sentiment.
All right, thank you.
Hi, Ben. I'm a freshman at UB from Dutchess County. You talked about divorce rates and how divorce rates have been increasing in this country since the 1970s, and kind of alluded to that as evidence of the failure of radical feminism.
Well, they sort of leveled off since like the 2000s, like the early 2000s, but yes, they're still higher than they were in the 50s and 40s.
Right. Couldn't that also simply be because of the fact that women are now more socioeconomically able to be independent than men? Like, how can you say that radical feminism caused divorces and also ignore the fact that possibly it was just that women became able to be independent, therefore they started to divorce more?
Because they would be becoming economically independent in the same period as they were getting divorced, as they were getting married. Meaning that these aren't 20-year marriages that are breaking up, these are like 5-year marriages that are breaking up, which suggests to me a mental shift that's taken place in the nature of how we think about marriage, rather than socioeconomic status being the indicator. But meaning that I suppose that economics could tie into this, except for the fact that people who are higher income tend to stay married more often than people who are lower income. Right, so that sort of undercuts the argument a little bit. meaning that if you're richer, you tend to be married longer on average. People who are poorer tend to get divorced
more
often.
Where did you get that statistical
trend? Census Bureau.
Hi, Ben. I just want to say I'm a huge fan of the show. I got the mug. I'm a subscriber.
Awesome. It's been overflowing this week, the leftist tears, hot or cold tumbler.
I never have to fill it up. The question I wanted to ask is, after the whole, I guess there's no better way to put it, but debacle involving the appointment of Justice Kavanaugh to the bench, do you think this is a moment where Americans as a society are going to start to maybe come back together and try to establish norms? Or is this just a moment where our politics are just going to further polarize and we're just going to start to tear apart even harder at the seams?
Number one, I love your optimism. I'm by nature a pessimist, which means I'm always right eventually. So my feeling is that when you see people who are screaming and trying to pry open 13-ton bronze doors in front of the Supreme Court as Brett Kavanaugh is being sworn in inside, and then you have full editorials in the New York Times saying that white women are racist because they supported Brett Kavanaugh, which I just don't even understand. I don't think this rift is going to be healed anytime soon. In fact, I think that the book that I have coming out next year is largely about why this giant rift has opened up in America in a time when we are historically wealthy, when we really don't have any major foreign crises on our hands. We don't have a lot in common anymore, is the sad truth. I mean, a nation is defined by a common history, a common culture, a common set of goals, common institutions. All of those things are being torn asunder by serious divides that we have about how we view our own central principles. And we used to be unified by a belief in God-given rights and limited government. Obviously, that doesn't unify us. We used to be unified by belief in Judeo-Christian virtue. That no longer unifies us. We used to be unified by a belief that America was essentially a good place, even though we'd never lived up to our full promise. Even that, I think, is no longer a unifying principle, which is why we now have people who see American history as in Howard Zinn fashion. It's just a long history of suffering and pain and patriarchal institutional discrimination. If those gaps don't get bridged, I think that we're headed toward a schism that is going to grow larger and larger over time. I don't see how. The only thing I could see is that eventually just disgust with the way this works means that, forget politics, somebody who's felt to be fundamentally decent ends up running for office, and you get a spate of those people running for office, and then it's about voting for the decency of the people as opposed to a particular political agenda.
Thank you so much for coming.
Hello, Ben. How are you doing tonight?
Doing okay. How are you?
So I'm a liberal, and
well, thank you for coming. I appreciate it.
Yeah, but at the same time, on the topic of free speech, I consider myself a libertarian.
That's why you're a liberal and not a leftist. You see, whenever I do my speeches,
right,
it's always liberal versus leftist. Liberals are people who disagree with me on politics, but aren't trying to attack me with machetes. And leftists are people who disagree with me on politics and are trying to shut down my speeches.
All right, so what I wanted to ask you about, so me personally, I disagree with many social networks' move to ban Alex Jones from their platforms, and I think it's a violation of the spirit of the First Amendment. But in comparison with that, I was asking, would you agree with me that by the NFL stopping Kaepernick from kneeling, is that also a violation of the First Amendment, the spirit of it in some sense? And do you believe that a corporation has the right to do what it wants, knowing about that First Amendment?
So there are several actual questions. Number one, do corporations have the right to do what they want? Yes, Facebook and the NFL have the right to do what they want, right? They're private corporations, they do. Now, the more important question is the first one you asked, about sort of the spirit of the First Amendment. I think that the real question is what these corporations are designed to do. So social networks were originally designed to facilitate discourse between various political sides. That's what they were designed to do. The NFL was not really designed to do that. The NFL presents a product, right? The NFL's product is what is on the field. If the NFL were to fine people for stuff that they said on Twitter, then I would suggest that the NFL was doing something wrong. For the NFL to say, you're affecting our viewership and the product that we present, that's a different thing. Just as if Alex Jones worked for CNN and he went on air and he started talking about, Satan, get behind me. Ah, I'm unbuttoning my shirt now. Look at this. Underneath, I got another shirt. Right, if he started doing that routine on CNN. he started doing that routine on CNN. I think at that point, CNN has every right to do whatever they want with him. So for the corporate question, the question is, what is the corporation designed to do? And the lie of Facebook and Twitter was that they were basically going to be essentially free open networks for discourse, and then it turns out that they're more publishers. They're more like my site or CNN, right, trying to add editorial guidance. What I think is that Facebook and Twitter, if they want to ban people, they should do so based on threats of violence, actual legal slander. Like that's where they should draw the line, not at stuff we don't like because Alex Jones is a nutball.
So can I have a quick follow-up, if you don't mind? Just
Sure.
So then, would you disagree with perhaps Tim Tebow's right to kneel in prayer on the field?
Yeah, if they'd find him for kneeling in prayer on the field, then they would have every right to do that, too.
All right. Thank you very much.
Hi, Ben. I want to start off and say I'm a huge fan of yours and would love the possibility to get a picture with you. And that and I'm truly hoping you run for presidency in 2024, although if you wanted to secure my vote during your campaign, then by some absolute miracle, I'd have to see you defeat Ocasio-Cortez in the debate.
But I don't know. Stop catcalling her, dude.
Yeah. But that brings me to my question. With college campuses becoming increasingly overwhelmed by professors with leftist teachings and rhetoric, I, like many other young conservatives, feel my back against the wall and not wanting to share my conservative views, especially on sensitive subjects, for running the risk of being ostracized by a mob of my classmates. What sort of advice would you give to this?
So my advice has always been to be practical, meaning that you have to decide what the risk-benefit analysis looks like exactly, the cost-benefit analysis. So when I was in law school, there were certain professors who were really great about debate. You know, people on the left who really enjoyed the fact that we go back and forth. And that was wonderful, I enjoyed it. And then there were certain professors who weren't. And those were the professors where I'd basically keep quiet because my grade was more important to me than making a point everyone was gonna forget 20 seconds later. If I wanted to talk to students outside of class, I would do it then. That's always been my view. I've never felt like you need to sacrifice your grade or sacrifice your future to make a point in class that everyone is gonna forget 15 seconds later, except for the professor who's gonna grade you down. The best path is to speak truth whenever possible, and when not possible, don't. Get good grades, make lots of money, threaten to withhold alumni funding, and then because discrimination in the classroom obviously shouldn't be approved by the administration.
Thanks, Ben.
Thanks.
Hey, Ben. I'm a big fan. I met you during the meet and greet when you came here earlier. And you touched on the issue of abortion, and I'll just like to ask a question, because I did a debate on abortion in high school, even though I don't necessarily agree with that. I was on the pro side, and I actually took it as an opportunity to learn from the other side. And although I can say that one of their main talking points was how if abortion was made illegal, then people would just get illegal abortions, and then twice the amount of people would die in the instance of that. But then I also said, well, that's not my issue. My issue is with how it's almost weaponized, like to say, like the left kind of weaponized it, where it's like, if you don't agree with abortion, like abortion is this amazing thing, an amazing right, an amazing power, but then I'm like, it's actually a really tough decision. It's not something I'm going to go celebrate and say, I'm really, like, it's awesome, it's a beautiful thing, and like, how do you think the left did that? Like, how do you think?
Well, I think the left actually came to a logical realization, which is that safe, legal, and rare is an untenable political position. So that was the Clintonian position in the 90s. They said, abortion should be safe, legal, and rare. Well, when you say that it should be rare, you're undercutting safe and legal, actually, or at least legal, right? Because the problem is, if you say it's rare, you're acknowledging that there is moral content to the action you are taking, which raises the question as to why it should be legal, right? So in other words, if it's what the left says, and it's just removal of a polyp, why should it be rare? I don't think polyp removal should be rare. I don't think anyone else believes that either. But when the left acknowledges there's a moral content to what it is that they're doing, they get themselves into a rhetorical trap. So instead it turns into, shout your abortion, be proud of your abortion. Be proud that it was like a step into womanhood to get an abortion. And anybody, I think, with any moral sense can see how terrible that is. But the left has made, you know, people who are left on abortion have made a crusade and a sacrament out of abortion in a way that they hadn't even when I was, you know, in high school. So it's pretty incredible and pretty horrifying. And that's why I've always thought, I mean, on Fox, I did my election special on Sunday. And on Fox, I did a monologue at the very end of the show about abortion.
Yeah, I remember that.
And the monologue on abortion, I think the best way to fight against the pro-choice position, the pro-abortion position, is to actually just show pictures of what it is that this baby is. Okay, because there's not a single Democrat in the Senate or in the House of Representatives that I know of who would vote to save a baby at the 12th week or 14th week. That's nuts. That's nuts. You can feel the baby kicking. I know, I've had two of them. You know, this is crazy talk. And the facts and the science happen to be on our side. One of my pet peeves on this issue is when people say, oh, you only say that because you're religious. You only say that because of the Bible. I have never invoked the Bible or God in any argument about abortion.
Yeah, I get that a lot, too.
It's idiotic. It's a way for them to avoid the necessary scientific conclusion from the fact that human life begins in fertilization. They don't want to talk science, so they accuse you of being a religious bigot, even though you're actually not invoking God.
I do hate that when they just say it's a clump of cells. That's just
what I say is you are technically a clump of cells as well.
Just a walking bulk,
because
like,
they are. You're a slightly more developed clump of cells, but that doesn't mean that you're none of the other arguments hold. The viability argument doesn't hold. There are plenty of human beings who are not viable outside support from machines or a pacemaker. We don't suggest that they can now be terminated. There are lots of people who don't have proper brain function, and babies. Or fetuses or embryos, which are going to develop proper brain function, to suggest that those babies are somehow lesser because of improper brain function for a temporary period, not even for a permanent period, that is obviously casting aspersions at people who don't necessarily have full brain function. It's very difficult to make an intellectually consistent case for why abortion ought to be treated as morally ambiguous. I have a tough time with it, frankly.
Thank you, Ben.
So I'm Robert. I'm one of the coastal liberals, as you'd say. I've been watching you for years now, and I read your book on the arguments to fight against people like me. And I feel bad because, like, for the most part, the people who have been arguing against you aren't nearly as elegant or eloquent as they should be. But I'd just like to ask, so one of your points you very strongly make is that it's unfair for, you know, people like me to label you as like a racist or a bigot, just as like a smear tactic. But have you ever acknowledged that, like, maybe it's not a smear tactic, but it's based on things you've said? So, like, for example, like, on the Israel-Palestine conflict, you know, you called the Arabs, you already know what I'm gonna say, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to presume. Yeah, so, like, you say—
I've written several full columns about it.
Yeah,
I've talked about how people don't read the follow-up tweets. I wrote a column—
I've read some of the tweets, and the tweets were just as bad. I mean, you say a lot of things that are just, like, racist, right? But then if I call you a racist, then you defend it by saying, like, I didn't read enough, right? So what I was going to say before, so you see the Arabs...
So give me my racist tweets in context.
Okay, well...
Yeah, you can't prepare. Go do it.
So you said the Arabs like to bomb crap and live in open sewage. This is not a difficult... Israelis like to build.
Did you... Okay, now the follow-ups, because you said the follow-ups didn't make it any better.
This is separate things that you said.
No. I want
bad.
The follow-ups to that one, though.
Follow-ups to that specific.
Would you like
tweet?
Me to get them? I'll get them for you.
If you have them, sure. But in the meantime, do you mind while you do that?
What was that?
Do you mind if I continue while you do that?
Well, I'd like to take them one by one. So
sure.
Why don't we do this? Why don't we delay that one until the end while I look this up from the podium in front of 600 people?
You've also said.
Okay.
I'll wait. So on that particular issue, you've also said that the Arab-Palestine populace is, by and large, constitutes the most evil population on the face of the planet. Before, you said that you've never brought up religion when it comes to abortion, but I don't think that you've avoided religion when it comes to the Israeli conflict, and I don't know that you can be completely unbiased in the issue, given that, you know...
I can be unbiased on the subject that the Palestinians have elected three terrorist governments to form a unity government with the stated goal of the destruction of the state of Israel and the murder of all Jews in the area. So that I can be relatively unbiased on. As far as the idea that the Palestinian population... the idea that the Palestinian population is more evil than other populations, they certainly hold more evil views than other populations by poll statistics, by how many Palestinians approve of terror attacks, by how many Palestinians voted for an actual terror group, Hamas, and another actual terror group, Palestinian Authority, and another actual terror group, the Islamic Jihad. Okay, so I don't think that all views are equal, and I don't think that people who hold evil views are necessarily good. I mean, I'm sorry if the polls don't support the idea that everyone is equally wonderful, but everyone is not equally wonderful. Okay, I'm looking up these statements now, so if you'd like to give me a second.
But you've continued, you deny secular Zionism, and you
Quote, there are, okay, so here, sure. I've got the okay, okay, so I'll finish that one, then we can move. Okay, ready? There are many, many Christian and Muslim Arabs who are wonderful people, just not the ones who oppose Israel and the Israel-Arab conflict. That would be okay. The response within the same Twitter thread. Okay, in the post re, Israelis versus Arabs, I wrote about Arabs who take part in the Israeli-Arab conflict, as anyone who can read knows. Hashtag dumbasses. Okay. Quote, I think it has much more to do with the fact that the Palestinian leadership, supported by the Palestinian population, uses millions for terror. I should have been more specific. Arabs who actively seek Israel's destruction. Those would be the follow-up tweets. Does that sound like genocidal mania to you, or does it sound like I'm specifically labeling a group of people who have called for Israel's destruction?
I like to point out that you're not a racist, but they're dumbasses, and you're allowed to insult them.
Yes, also, because if someone calls me a racist without evidence, they are definitionally a dumbass.
What is genocide? Wait. What is genocide? Like the you said that you want to be like Churchill, right? And after the Allies, when they moved the German-speaking Polish out of Poland.
So now you're talking about a column I wrote when I was 19 years old that I morally abhorred and denounced myself. I think 6 years ago.
Yeah, you
and have repeatedly and have repeatedly said was a bad column that I wrote when I was 19 years old.
Okay.
Okay, so.
I wish I had more time. Like. Do you wanna get a drink sometime? Like a non-alcoholic beverage?
What was that say one more time?
Do you wanna get a non-alcoholic drink sometime? Because I have a lot here. I really do. I know that
you've got a book let me just say this. For everything that you're going to say, yeah. I've addressed literally every one of those points. I have a column that I put out probably only a few months ago. And the literal title of it is, so here's a giant list of all the dumb stuff I've ever done. Don't worry, I'll keep updating it.
I didn't get that one in my research. I apologize if I've misrepresented, my research wasn't able to be so thorough. Because it was pretty last-minute decision to start, really going in trying to ask you a question.
And again, that's totally fine, and I appreciate you coming, and I appreciate you asking me the questions. But if the notion is that I'm a racist before you actually read all of my responses
the racist is just one part. I also like the transgender. Like, you don't believe in transgenders, and that's not really
supported
by biology.
I don't know what that means. I don't believe in transgenders. I mean, transgender people exist. It's not something you believe in or not.
You've said. You've said that gender and sex are the same thing.
I said that gender and sex are linked. I've said that femininity and masculinity are linked to male and female.
Just before you said that they're...
Right, there are two genders. I don't believe there are 1,000 genders. And if I think that if you're defining gender as just a random series of societal constructs, then there aren't two genders, there are infinite numbers of genders because everybody is a mix of feminine and masculine. So why restrict it to 70 genders? Make it 6 billion genders since we all have our unique mix of what male and female constitute. And I don't, I don't think that there can be such a thing as a male in a female's body. I don't think that there is a female in a male's body, and I find the logic to support that and the science to support that utterly lacking.
Yeah.
I'd be happy to get a non-alcoholic beverage with you and discuss it more fully. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is John, and I am a senior doing a political science major, and I would like to ask the question in regards to this. Sorry, it's my first time ever doing
this sort of thing. No worries, don't go over that. It's fine.
Okay. You stated that you didn't care about people's concern about the browning of America, which, in my opinion, is essentially not caring about the issue of illegal immigration.
No, that's not right. Go ahead.
and yet you support Israel's ethnostate by stating that Judaism must be preserved, since elements like this uphold Jewish national identity and culture, which I don't mind. But the fact that you don't care about the demographic change in America is kind of concerning, because we're all Americans here, right?
Okay.
And, the question is, do you want our nation to end up like a third world country such as Brazil, or a disaster like Germany and Sweden right now?
Okay, so Brazil's a second world country, technically. It's a developing country. It's not like a fully underdeveloped country or a failed state.
Then why is there a far right candidate winning at the moment?
I mean, if you want to argue Brazilian politics, I agree that Brazilian politics have been dominated by the far left, but I'm not sure that that's of tremendous interest. Let's talk about the first question. Okay, when I say I don't care about the browning of America, what I mean is I don't care about ethnicity. It doesn't make any difference to me. The only thing that makes a difference to me is the ideals of the people who are coming across the border. Now, when people say I am pro-illegal immigration, I do not know where in the hell they would possibly get that. This seems to, when people repeatedly say stuff like this, like, and I see this meme all the time, oh, Shapiro cares about a Jewish ethnostate, but he doesn't care about illegal immigration. I was further right than Donald Trump was in the last election cycle on illegal immigration. I opposed the 2006 amnesty deal. I opposed the 2010 amnesty deal. I've consistently been anti-illegal immigration. I supported the wall. This is just a lie. The idea that I'm pro-illegal immigration is not true in the slightest. What I have said is that we ought to deal with how to stop the influx of illegal immigration and then deal with the people who are here and separate off the two issues. And when it comes to the folks who are here illegally, what we should do is we should assess those folks in the same way we assess everybody else coming into the country. Are they going to add economically to the country and culturally to the country? Are they going to make the country a better place? Or are they going to make the country a worse place? And that involves assimilation. Now, as far as the idea of the Jewish ethnostate, I don't care very much about, at all actually, about Jewish ethnicity. Jewish ethnicity makes no difference to me. What does make a difference to me is Jewish ideals, because I care about Judeo-Christian ideals in the United States, and I care about Jewish ideals in Israel, which is why I don't care, and I'm very happy, that thousands, tens of thousands of Ethiopian Jews who are black were flown to Israel to become Israelis. I'm very happy that tens of thousands of Russian Jews who were Russian were flown from Russia to become Israelis. My wife is Moroccan, right? She's Moroccan Israeli. So this idea that it's about ethnicity as opposed to ideology or ideas is just not true. The amazing thing about Judaism, just like most other religions, is you can become one. Okay, I can't become a black man. There's no way for me to do it, right? I can become a Christian. You could become a Jew, right? This means that there are ideological systems that you can buy into that allow you entry. And I believe that the United States should operate the same way. You can become an American if you buy into Central American ideals, but I'm not gonna pretend that I care whether a bunch of people who are pro-America and pro-American ideals come from Cuba versus coming from Britain.
I understand that. I respect your beliefs and your right to hold them, Ben. I just think that personally—
I have a question for you. Why are you equating white or race with culture? Why are you saying these are the same thing?
Well, because most, Jews mostly practice Judaism, and just like,
Most Jews actually don't practice Judaism, technically speaking. Most ethnic Jews are lefties.
Most of them are part of that. So it's only a minority of people that want to convert to Judaism, which I don't mind.
Okay, and it's only a minority of people who want to become Americans, or we should let in if they want to become Americans enough. I'm asking not about Israel, but I'm asking you about America.
Okay.
I'm asking you about America. So you're saying that you object to the so-called browning of America. Why?
Well, I'm just saying I object to illegal immigration, which,
So do I, but your original question was about the browning of America,
yeah,
so why?
It's basically like the open borders,
I agree with you about illegal immigration.
That's going on right now.
I agree with you about illegal immigration. Yeah. I asked you about, not about that. I'm asking you about the browning of America phrase, because that's what you objected to.
Okay,
I said I don't care about the browning
of America.
The
whole entire culture is changing at the moment, just so you know.
I understand that culture is changing at the moment, but I do not think that culture and race are inseparable. I don't think that brown people are less capable of becoming American, or black people are less capable of becoming American, or Jews, or anybody else.
And I agree that, when people come to this country, including, myself and my family who immigrated here illegally in the 80s, and I think that, that people that do it, they follow the law and they assimilate, they should do that.
Right. I mean, let's put it this way. Can we agree on this? I care about the liberalizing of America and the destruction of American values. I don't care about what the nature of the people who look like is who believe in American values. Those people are my family. Everybody who doesn't believe in those American ideals is not.
All right. Thank you.
This will be the last question, ladies and gentlemen. This will be the last question.
Hey, how's it going?
Big Ben, what's up with you?
How's it going, dude?
Hey, I'm doing all right. Okay, so my question is, first I'm going to kind of...
I need to give you this hammer. You're enormous, dude. you can wield this much better than I can. I look like one of the dwarves from Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. I'm like, go mining or something.
Appreciate that. First I'm going to kind of paraphrase another speaker who kind of operates along the same tone. In America, Jordan Peterson, Dr. Jordan Peterson.
Yeah.
So one of the things that he often talks about is at the basis or the premise of the ongoing debate between conservatism versus liberalism is that at the basis of each, conservatism is like the protection of the hierarchy, whereas on the liberal side, it's more so the protection and promotion of egalitarianism. And so my question to you is, one thing that he makes clear is that both sides are necessary for, or are ideal in a country that moves forward at a fast pace, as the United States has done. And so my question to you is, it seems as though you have a more hostile, you have such a hostility towards liberals and leftists, whereas I don't often hear you at all say that there's anything that you can learn from their side. In his book, 12 Rules of Life, one of the chapters is assume that the person in which you're speaking with has something to offer you as far as intellectually that you may learn from them. So my question to you is, I guess, what is your position? Like, do you feel as though a liberal, well, obviously a liberal, but liberals in general or leftists in general have anything to bring to the table from an ideology standpoint or intellectually?
I mean, passion for change is obviously, it can be a good thing when directed in the proper channels. As you say, the left's focus on egalitarianism is good so long as it is focused on the equal application of rights, not on the false attempts to override biology and natural hierarchy. So I think Jordan would agree with me on the idea that if you butt up against a natural hierarchy, or if you butt up against natural differences, because I don't think every difference is a hierarchy. If you butt up against natural difference, you butt up against reality. Trying to override reality with artificial equality is going to be a giant failure and can, as Jordan would say, murder millions in the process, right? That's what Jordan thinks communism was. It was basically there are differences between human beings. Failure to respect those differences is what, in the name of equality, is what leads to the gulags. So while Jordan is, I think he's a little bit less robust in the language that he uses with regard to left, he's just as anti-left with regard to the focus on hardcore egalitarianism. Where the left, so I do think, and I do make a distinction between, as I've said, liberals and
liberals
the left.
And left. Sure.
The left is a far more censorious force, and they want to censor a lot more. They're a lot more tyrannical. They want to control a lot more from the top. People who are liberals who are arguing over the proper scope of government in particular areas, there I think there's plenty to learn, and I think that you can have fulsome exchanges about the nature of what sort of social welfare state can be supported or is appropriate. And you can have a data exchange on that sort of thing. Where you can't really have an exchange is when you're running up against, is when people are falsifying the facts, as they are when they say that men and women are exactly the same, for example. So I appreciate the critique, and I'll try to take that to heart.
Sure.
And I think that, and I will acknowledge also that I think that folks had a lot more to learn from the left in the 1960s than they do now, because the country has moved in a lot of very good ways since the 1960s, and in some bad ways since the 1960s.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Can I ask another question? Or?
Yeah, one more. Go for it.
We have another one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and this has to do with the whole, national anthem in players kneeling during games in the NFL.
Yeah.
And so my question is this, is I feel that regardless of whether you agree with the act or not, someone taking a knee during the national anthem at the beginning of a football game, I believe that if you don't say, okay, I disagree with the act, I don't think it's the right place, I don't think it's the right whatever the case may be, however, I agree with it in so much as I would like to protect that individual's freedom of speech. And my question is, I don't hear you certainly, or a lot of anyone on the conservative side or right side, as you would call it, as someone may call it, defending, saying, okay, look, I don't agree with it, but I agree with that person's freedom of speech in that moment, or utilizing
so
that act.
So it depends on the forum. So this is a public university. I have a right to speak here, right? There's a difference between that and, for example, DePaul University. So DePaul University is a private university. Last year, I think it was last year, DePaul invited me to speak, or at least some of the students did. The administration said I couldn't, and when I showed up on campus, they threatened to arrest me. I didn't sue the university, because they have a right to do that. I think they're wrong, I think they're foolish, but they have a right to do that.
Okay.
So Colin Kaepernick does not have the right to kneel on the sidelines of a private NFL event. If he wants to kneel in a park,
now,
he's more than welcome
to do so. According to who, he doesn't have the right?
Well, he doesn't have the legal right. He can't sue the NFL to force them
Oh, so he can't sue the NFL, certainly.
So that's the distinction that I'm making. When it comes, like, if Colin Kaepernick were to come here, like right here, you know, and like after the event that we haven't organized, he wants to kneel on the stage all day long, that's totally fine. It's a public university, he can do what he wants.
Certainly.
So time, place, and manner restrictions are a thing, and so is private versus public. So I'll defend Colin Kaepernick's right to say whatever the hell he wants in any public area, so long as he's not violating the rights of private property owners to control their property, because they do have rights. Like, he couldn't come into my living room and just kneel on the floor.
Do you think the conversation is based around the fact that the NFL is a private organization, or is it based around the fact that they feel that that action disrespects our military in that moment because the national anthem is so associated?
Well, I think the NFL handled this in the worst way possible, which is they allowed certain messages and not other messages.
Then
right?
We're on the same page.
Right. So like a few years ago, there were a bunch of guys in Missouri who did the hands up, don't shoot symbol coming at the St. Louis Rams. They came out of the tunnel doing the hands up, don't shoot. They weren't fined. Nothing happened. If the NFL wants to set a standard that you're not allowed to make political statements during the games or in the warm-ups or something, totally cool. But if they're going to be inconsistent in the application of those standards, then I've got a bit of a problem with them. And I think that Roger Goodell has done a terrible job with that. And you know how you know this? Because David Stern actually banned people from sitting for the national anthem in 1996 with Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, and nothing happened. He set the standard. That was the end of it. If you want to go protest, don't protest here. Go protest somewhere else, and nobody cared. But that's really not even the large. Look, the larger issue about Kaepernick is, you know, whether it is appropriate generally for people to kneel for the national anthem or whether we should be insulted by that. You know, my feeling is that it's generally not appropriate, but you have having a right to do something does not make it the appropriate or right thing to do. I don't think that kneeling for the national anthem is either smart politics or the right thing to do, because there are certain things that still have to unify us, like the idea the country is based on good foundations. And if he wanted to kneel for the national anthem outside a police station, I think that would be a lot more useful for his supposed cause than, you know, taking millions and millions of dollars of contracts from Nike to pretend to be a social justice warrior. I'm very skeptical of Colin Kaepernick. I think there are a lot of people who actually care about these issues and have studied the issues and don't wear socks with pictures of cops as pigs on them.
I just want to say thank you. And I agree that if that was going to happen, Colin Kaepernick may not have been the best proponent, the best individual to make that stand in that situation. Thanks
a lot.
Well,
I appreciate it. Thank you so much for coming. Hey, how's it going?
Good evening, Mr. Shapiro. My name is Chanel Powell. Nice to meet you.
You too.
So, I'm a liberal in view. Those are my views, and while we
Well, again, thank you for coming. I appreciate when people who disagree come.
Well, I appreciate you coming to our campus and speaking with us. So I came here essentially out of support for YAF, and I also came here to listen and learn from you, from what you're saying. I think it's important to see opposite sides and discuss, right? But my question to you is, how do we essentially bridge the gap from two different points of view? How are we able to meet in the middle? By listening, I mean, essentially, we want the same thing. We want better for our country and better for our people. Everyone in this room is our people. How do we take care of them? How do we meet in the middle and take care of them?
Well, I mean, I think that we actually have to determine, to be completely frank, whether we do want the same thing. Because I think that sometimes people on left and right think they want the same thing in vague terms, like better country. But we actually have to determine what better country looks like. So do we want a country where there's more freedom to rise and fall economically, or do we want a country with more enforced rigidity of income, for example? That's an actual difference in goal. Do we want a country where men and women are free to pursue whatever lives that they want, encouraged to pursue virtue at the same time, or do we see that encouragement by social groups to virtue as a sort of block and check on freedom? You know, there are certain areas where we have to clarify exactly what we think an ideal America looks like. My ideal America is basically John Stuart Mill's America. You get to do whatever you want, you wave your hand around as much as you want until you hit somebody in the face, but that is also contingent on all of us trying to act virtuously toward our neighbors. So I think that the great genius of the founders, that they were balancing the sort of European Enlightenment view of liberty with the more traditionalist view of what private citizenry looked like, which was a duty-based private citizenry, of duty to your neighbor, not based on what government tells you to do. I'm not sure that that's what the ideal America looks like necessarily for a lot of folks on the left who feel perhaps that individual rights need to take a back seat to collective solutions, right? So, for example, my ideal America is not an America where the government forces doctors to provide care at a certain price, because I think that a free market solution is not just better for healthcare. I think it's more moral. I think that a consent-based society is a more moral society in economics. A lot of folks on the left say, well, consent-based society won't get us to universal healthcare, right? So these are serious conversations and serious discussions. I think the way that we can have a conversation is actually by sitting and defining terms. So very few conversations begin with the defining of the terms. They sort of start with second-order conversations. So instead of saying, what do you want healthcare to look like in America? What are your competing rights and values? Instead, we start with, we all want the same thing, and therefore nationalized healthcare. Or we all want the same thing, and therefore complete privatization. We might not actually want the same thing. So we might want to start with that discussion first. What do you want to see? So what I would like to see in some of these areas is more individual freedom, and then social networks outside of government picking up the slack. That's what my ideal America looks like. For a lot of folks on the left, they don't trust the social networks. They think that the government has to come in and take care from the top down. These are fundamentally different views of the country. And I'm not sure that they are completely bridgeable. We can have conversations about them, but in the end, I think that clarity is sometimes preferable to agreement in ambiguity.
Well, I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.